Shri Gauri Vaishnava Guru Parampara ki jai. Shri Shri Gauri Nityananda ki jai. Shri Shri Ram Shri Gopal Shri Shri Gauri Radha Maharaj ki jai. Gauri Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. Gauri Prema. Nice to be here with you all again. I've been here for a couple of days, and I was fortunate to meet with some devotees last night at Krishna Karnam's house, Rasna's house, and we had a nice discussion with some devotees who won't be able to come to the festival. Nice opportunity for me. And I was hosted there very nicely. And I had a good opportunity to be escorted here. And stop for lunch along the way. So, privileged and honored and to be with some of you I haven't seen in some time. And so I'm a little tired tonight. Ashram Maharaj is here, of course, as well. And he'll be speaking along with myself throughout the week. We'll all be here for the whole week. So I thought tonight I'd just ask if you had any questions, we could talk in more informally amongst friends. Any questions tonight? Yes?
Yesterday you said in the after class that main speaker of Bhagavatam, they are mainly of general the Krishna devotees, and they are in Vaidhi and Raga mood, and some are in the mix of these both. Can you explain more about this mix of Vaidhi and Raga mood?
Whoops. Yeah, the point that I was making is the point that's raised in Krishna Sandhara, which is Goswami. The point being that all of the principal speakers and all of the principal questioners, like Sudei, Krishna, Nara, and Vyas, is thought to be central.
And so I mentioned that some of the devotees who are devotees of Krishna are writing bhaktas in Paris. Like Narada, for example. And the question is, based on the fact that I said similar in the mix between a mixture of Raga and Vaidhi. So, could I say more about that? Right? I mentioned last night that while we are accustomed to thinking primarily of Raga in relation to Vrindavan, the reason for that is because this is the kind of Raga Bhakti that Swami writes about in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. After he explains Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti, then he explains Raga Sadhana Bhakti. And explaining that Raga Sadhana Bhakti, he speaks of that all in relation to following the inhabitants of Vrindavan, following their ecstasy, their love, remembering them, serving them, and attaining the same love thereby of them, and so forth. And so here, Raga Bhakti pertains only to Vrindavan, and really not a sign of that center of the lotus of Goloka that is the brunch of Vrindavan. The outside of that is Raga Bhakti, but that's not entirely the case. So there is a spectrum of Raga Bhakti, and I think we can say that there are those that are purely devotees, examples purely of Vaidhi Bhakti, those that are examples of purely of Raga Bhakti, and then there are those who are whose bhakti is mixed. The curious thing perhaps I found curious is that this spectrum, if you will, of Raga Bhakti, between Raga and Vaidhi Bhakti, or let's say the extension of Raga Bhakti, as explained by Jiva Goswami in Bhakti Sandarbha, goes not only outside of Braj, from Mathura and the Dwarka leaders, but also arguably into Vaikuntha, because he has described Prahlad Maharaj as a Raga Bhakta. Prahlad Maharaj, his deity was Krishna, but he's not a player in Raja Lila, at least not as Prahlad. Prahlad's love was tested. Bhagavan and Srinidhi appeared before him and said, take a blessing from me. He said, I don't want anything. He said, no, I got it, and I give blessings, that's what I do. So you should take something from me. Everybody wants something from me. I know you're just a kid, but I have to educate you. That's what I do. I'm God. Everybody wants something from me. Take something. No, I don't want anything. No, I don't want anything. He insisted, insisted, insisted. And of course, all the devas, gods, his or in heaven, is trembling because they all want something. And Prahlad didn't want anything. And so, of course, ultimately he was pushed by the Trinidad, and therefore he asked that he was still happy upon his father, to which the Trinidad said, that's already been done a long time ago. That's a given. So he was sustaining his love. The exclusivity of his love was tested. So he was going to make a comment along these lines that just see the glory of the sovereign siddhas. It's a nice point, and it's a nice point in relation to a present day, I would say, problem in the Gaudiya international community, where it is common to, in some circles, to think of one's guru as a nitya siddha and not as a sovereign siddha, as if being a sovereign siddha is problematic, is something less, is not the most becoming. Something like that. And it's often done in relation to micromarsh. Prabhupada had a discussion about this recently, where I was asked to lend a voice and opinion to a discussion where this topic came up. And it tends to get emotional, but I was very calm in presenting kind of just the facts. And there are a number of places, 3, 4, 5 places in his books where Maharaj writes about himself, describing himself very clearly as a sovereign siddha. And the statements he makes are very, very clear and descriptive, and he even cites the Gita. I think in the Gita text, where Arjuna poses the interesting question, having been asked to forego dharma in pursuit of this elusive Atma that Krishna describes in the second chapter. It's hard to grip on, to understand. Those who've seen it will understand it. Those who speak about it say it's amazing. Those who hear about it say it's amazing. Nobody understands it. That's how he concludes. Krishna concludes his description of the Atma consciousness. And of course, having done that, he goes on to speak about how one can nonetheless realize it through yoga. And he begins that discourse about yoga by speaking about bhakti yoga. The other pramanashosi bhattavayanirite svalakum apyasanamasya tayate matubayat. This is clearly a description of bhakti yoga, in that the yoga of jnana, the yoga of karma, being under the influence of sattva and rajas respectively, cannot produce results that are eternal. And this verse says, Neha, Brahmanajati, Bhattavayanati, sorrow obvious balance, try to take on to it. Even with a little bit of effort in this yoga that will ultimately teach you about is such, it's worth knowing because it's eternal and you cannot lose it. There's no falling from it, so to speak. He goes on, of course, in the chapters that follow, and in that chapter as well, the second chapter, speak about different kinds of yoga. And this is the way of the Gita, that what Krishna wants to speak about and emphasize, which is ananya bhakti, ananya bhakti. He does so directly and indirectly, directly by many statements throughout the Gita, like this statement, his first statement about yoga. What is the difference between it and the other types of yoga governed by the different modes, other people, the jhana, influenced by different modes of nature? These kind of statements makes throughout. Again and again, this theme is brought up directly in the Gita of Anubhakti. And so these are examples of how he's speaking directly about the subject of the book. And then there are statements that are indirectly bringing our attention to the subject of the book, Ananya Bhakti, by way of contrast. So I might say, this is what I want to say, and there's also this, and see the difference between the two. So he speaks directly about bhakti and indirectly about bhakti. What are its virtues and what are the shortcomings of other types of spiritual disciplines? So it's not just to pick or choose, if you understand the Gita in context. Pick this yoga or that yoga. Prabhupada was often, when he met with guests and they said they were familiar with the Gita, he would ask, do you know the conclusion? And often they would say, I didn't know there was any particular conclusion. It's kind of like what the book is, kind of open it up and it lands on the page that you're supposed to read for that day and so forth. It has a conclusion, to be sure. And so, it's interesting, of course, that Krishna begins his discourse on yoga in the first six chapters with a verse about bhakti, and he concludes his discourse about yoga with a verse about bhakti. What does he say at the end of the sixth chapter? Yoginam api sarvesham apitnanta shadvan vatejo sami yuta tmo sami yuta tmo yuta utama. And bhakti is the most of the yuktas, the yuking that yoga does. It is yuta utama, the best. So, because Why? Because he's not the body. But what he is this very like hard to get a grip on thing called Atma, consciousness. And as you spoke about that, then again, as I'm saying, yoga is the means to realize something that by any other method is unknowable. This is an inward movement, yoga, for knowing self. And we are accustomed to knowing by moving outward through acquisition, through interacting with sense objects, with our tools of the senses, our tools of mind, intellect, and so forth. These tools are not in and of themselves useful for finding the self. You'll never be apprehended by them. So, special and very different way from the way which we ordinarily proceed and come to know about the world is promoted if we're pursuing knowing and coming to know the self. It's called yoga. But yoga is not that easy either. We say that bhakti yoga is easy, but it's only easy in comparison to other yogas. But it's not so easy. And Arjun brings it up. He says, I think it's difficult what you're talking about. You have to control the mind. Of course, in bhakti, it becomes easy comparatively because we have something very beautiful to put on the mind. The qualities of Krishna, the leelas of Krishna, the name of Krishna, and so forth. Rather than just self-thinking, these thoughts, if you will. And the problem with our thoughts is really that they're preoccupied with things. That is the problem with them. And the self is not a thought or a thing. And thoughts that are preoccupied with things are particularly problematic. But there can be other kinds of thoughts. This is yoga then. That's why Krishna says, and the self is the friend, and the mind is the enemy, and the friend of the self. So yoga is the training of the mind to make it a friend. And so bhakti is a very friendly form of yoga because it gives us something very beautiful to put on the mind, if you will. The ordinary idea of yoga is to cleanse the chitta vritti nirodha. What does Chaitanya Mahaprabhu say in relation to this? Chaito dharma marjana. That this chitta, he says, is like a mirror. It's the organ of kind of internal organ of perception, and when we focus it on material objects, then that chitta takes the form of those objects, and impressions are imprinted on this chitta. And then we're driven by those impressions to act in certain ways that are not in the interest of realizing ourself. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that this sankirtan, which is his method, central to bhakti, is kirtan. It's one of the angas of bhakti. That this kirtan in the beginning, it cleanses the chitta of all these samskaras, vasanas, impressions for material life. But in the context of cleansing them, if we study the Shikshasakam, which I think is clear, but in the context of cleansing of the heart or chitta of material impressions, samskaras that are driving our material life, in the context of cleansing it, impressions of bhakti are being imprinted on Amidhiya Chitta. So be careful who you associate with. And actually it is association with devotees that gives rise to the worship of a particular form of Bhagavan. In other words, if you associate with Ram Bhaktas, then you will worship Ram. If you associate with Krishna Bhaktas, then naturally, by that alone, that association, who you worship will be determined. And who you worship then determines what your preeti will be. Preeti, love, praise, a function of the a relationship with Bhagavan is a function of preeti, a form, a swarup. In other words, it facilitates the love that the relationship with Bhagavan is about a form, shape, approach, or swarup. So its genesis really is sadhusanga. You understand? Sadhusanga. So when we associate with sadhus, whatever they say to us, whatever they do, whatever they move, and so they're moving under certain impressions themselves. Mahatma Samparta, Daiva Pratimashita. They're moving under the Sru Shakti, not under the influence of Maya Shakti, moving under the influence of Bhakti, and a particular type of Bhakti. And so, impressions on that type of body will be imprinted on our consciousness. And as we progress subsequently by engaging in the body, those impressions will come to the surface. And we will say, I want to serve like that, like a friend of Krishna, like a lover of Krishna, like a parent of Krishna, as if that's what I'm not letting my choice. We can only choose the opportunities that are presented, among the opportunities that are presented to us. And we present the opportunity of bhakti through sadhusanga and through a particular type of sadhusanga. I mean, we are holy questions, so we influence holy questions. And the sadhus and holy questions are basically two types. You see, because the lords, the gods, the samasti gurus of holy Vaishnavas and Mahu, Vande Shri Krishna Chaitanya, Nityananda Rosa Bodhito, Gaura and Nityananda Gopa, both. Rajanana Ye Sachisito Vyose, Bharam Vito Nitai. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, we know he came to taste Mother Rasa. This is a very extraordinary leader, to be sure. What did Balaram do? Balaram, a very curious person. Of all of the avatars in Prakash, I'll get to your question. I'm getting a little carried away. Of all the avatars and all of the Prakashas, the form of God manifested in Parabhyoma, in Vaikuntha, an avatar comes down from there into this world, crossing down avatars. Of all of them, we have Narasimha Bhagavan, Matsya Bhagavan, Kurma Bhagavan, this Bhagavan, that Bhagavan. Different forms of Krishna, Mathuresh Krishna, Dwarakesh Krishna. All these forms of Bhagavan have Shakti consorts. Isn't it? They all have. But Balaram learn now. This is the original Bhagavatam. Not Balaram in Mathura, not Balaram in Dwarka, not Sankarshan in Vaikuntha, but Balaram in Vrindavan. Balaram in Vrindavan, does he have a Shakti title? Yes. What is their name?
Ananda.
Ananda. But what is my point? Who can say? What is the point I'm making?
But Ananda Manjari is Balaram himself?
No. He's the Radha is the Shakti title of Krishna. Is Radha Rani Krishna herself? Yes and no, but we emphasize no. What is the point? Balaram's Shakti is Ananda Manjari. Balaram has no relationship with her.
Yeah.
You understand? That is not his consort. This is peculiar, isn't it? All the forms of Balaram, they all have consort, romantic love, and Balaram or Balaram. He does not have that. He has some gopis. That is a secondary thing in Mariyada Mark. But Raga Mark Balaram is living only for Krishna. Krishna wants to taste Madhuri Rasa. Balaram wants to help him. That is his position. So, as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, as Krishna comes as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Balaram comes every time to help Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And to attract others to him, that they might take advantage of the overflow of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's own pursuit. Because when Krishna, as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, is pursuing the Bhava of Radha, then he's off balance. And there's an opportunity to get close to him that is otherwise not presented to us. And in his madness of this pursuit that his Bhava is overflowing, and no one did more to distribute this, make this available than the Nityananda Guru. See this dedication to Krishna. But he has his own Bhava also. As a friend, he is the friend of Krishna. Guru Bhakari Vidasmi. Guru Bhakari Vida Priyam. This is a nice statement that Krishna made to Narada. Narada caused a disturbance in Dwarka by talking about Krishna in Vrindavan, and then Krishna went mad in separation, and all kind of everybody in Dwarka was upset. Krishna, what's going to happen? May leave now. And so, you know, the story of the Bhagavatam, and then they created a fake Vrindavan, a new Vrindavan, another Vrindavan, and Krishna woke up and he thought he was in Vrindavan, and so forth. They tried to pacify him, in other words. So Narada thought, oh my God, I made a big mistake. I made a big disturbance. And when Krishna realized all that happened, he said, don't think like that. Guru Bhakari is the Vrindavan. He is the Guru Upakari, the best friend, Upakari, the best helper. Upakari, the best friend is the one who reminds one of his beloved. Guru Upakari Smriti Dhakyam. The best friend is the one who reminds another of his beloved. So Narada reminded him, right, of his beloved, of Radha and the Raj, and he caused a big disturbance, that kind of disturbance. inherently desirable. So we find Balaram Vidhanadaram in this role. And doing so much to assist Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and bring us to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, but invariably some people will be infected by his own Baba, and we see examples of that. So we have these, as I call them, windows of opportunity presented to us in Gopi Vaishnava's Sadrasa and the Mandirvilas of Radhadasa. Not every Sampradaya presents every opportunity. Sri Sampradaya has a certain tattva, and corresponding with that tattva, there are certain bhavas. Mubarak Sampradaya has a certain tattva, a way of explaining the ground out of which a certain bhava for Krishna arises. Sakhi bhava for the Mubarakis. And nobody else is there. Only the Sakhis. No Nanda, no Yashoda, no Sambhava, just the Sakhi. There are many possibilities, you understand, in transcendence. We have to also do the Bhava Sampradaya, a certain tattva, and a certain Bhava arising out of it. Bodhi Vaishnavas is not different. It's not that Bodhi Vaishnavas offers all powers. In a way it does. How so? We have seen practically that Gaudiya Vaishnavism gives currency in the modern world, has given currency to all the different sampradayas. But in no particular, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's sampradaya will come and unify all the sampradayas, something like that. It's kind of happened in a way that all these sampradayas, like Madhva Sampradaya, like Ramanuja Sampradaya, Bhava Sampradaya, they've all gotten followers in the modern world and foot in the modern world through the influence of the Gaudiya Sampradaya. So we saw a visitor last night, and speaking to him, he's asking me, he's like speaking about Krishna's Kumbha, the most family, Krishna's Rasaraj, and how only in relation to Krishna is it possible for the entirety of emotional experience and love to be realized. He said, well, what about, you know, Sri Sampradaya? They're not completely loved, God, I see they do, but there's no Mother Rasa there. Maybe something like mixed Vaidhi Bhakti and Raga Bhakti, the queens of Dwarka, you can get through Ramanuja Sampradaya. Or Mother Sampradaya, you can get Sevati, and so on and so forth. So, this is an important point, that the tantra that we learn, the siddhanta that we learn, is not separate from the bhava that we will attain. It corresponds. The tantra that we learn, on the one side, takes away ideas that we have. Having heard the philosophy, we think we've understood it. When we hear more or less, oh, it's not quite like that. I was carrying this idea, this impression. I understood it through the filter of my conditioning this way or that way. So by continuing to hear the tattva, siddhanta through sadhu sangha, all this will be stripped away. All these other ideas. What is the jiva? What is bhakti? What is the prayojan, tattva, and so forth. This is forming the swarup. When anybody wants to offer prayer to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, swarup dhamma would be the filter. It had to be correct in tattva and bhava. So these things, that's why we emphasize this. We have our literary legacy, our scriptural canon of the Gaudiyas. There are other ways also to worship Bhagavan, but there's a particular way in Gaudiya Vaishnavism, particular opportunities that the tradition presents to us. In the context of that, of course, they say it gives currency to all of it. So, Bhakti Yoga, very nice. Very nice, very easy, beautiful, beautiful thing to put on the mind, right? If you have to still the mind, Arjuna said, oh, how do I still the mind? It's very difficult. He told me about the Atma. That was confusing enough. And when he came, he said, when you told me the Atma is not like this, it's not like that, it's not like this, it's not like that, it can't be burned, okay. It can't be drowned, okay. It can't be cut by any weapon, okay. What is it, exactly? When is that? It's not like this, and it's not like that, and it's not like this, and it's not like that. It goes on and on. It's sat. What's that? Everything transforms. He said it's the one thing that doesn't change, doesn't transform. It's not like anything else. Everything else is coming and going, transforming around us. All the things are transforming, right? From ashes to ashes, I think they say in the Bible. Somebody else. Everything matter is constantly transforming. It's not transforming. It's a very abstract way to talk about something. And Arjuna more or less says it traditionally. You've told me all about it, you know, in so many verses, but I don't really get it. What is it? It's not a thought, it's not a thing, and that's all I know is thoughts and things. Really? Is that all you know is thoughts and things? This is the question. There's only one thing you know, it's not really a thing, it's not really a thought. We think, I am this, or I am that. I am Polish, or I am American, I am man, I am woman, I am fat, I am tall, I am skinny, I am hungry, I am full. All these things. I am this, or I am that. There are many thises and many thats. But there is one thing that doesn't change. What is that? We say, I am this, I am that. What doesn't change? I am. That doesn't change. You understand? And the I am is bigger than any this or any that. Even the Brahman. I am Brahman. That is very small compared to I am. But because we think I am this or I am that, we forget that I am. But that is the only thing that we really know, that I am. All any other knowledge proceeds from that. We can't be sure about anything else except I am. That I know. Because if I'm not, there is no knowing anyway. This is all knowing proceeds from this. The yoga wants to bring us back to this. It's a very different way of thinking, see, than we're accustomed to. And Arjuna is hearing about it with Krishna. He's not quite getting it. He says, what you said about the self, it's supposed to bring end all suffering. Arjuna is suffering in his heart. Even if you're good, good thoughts bring suffering also. Good thoughts and bad thoughts. You get good thoughts. But in the nature of the world, they're causing suffering, isn't it? So, Krishna telling you, this will end all suffering. And he said, what are you talking about? And so what did Krishna say? Krishna concludes his discussion by saying, yeah, I mean, it's really, what is it? People see it, they say it's amazing. People hear about it, say it's amazing. People talk about it, they say it's amazing. It's amazing, it makes them feel amazed. And even after knowing it, nobody knows it, he says. What kind of thing is this that is supposed to end all suffering and we are supposed to pursue? And again, oh, this is another thing. How do you pursue it? Through yoga, not through his ears, not through the eyes, unto themselves, in relation to sense objects, for the eye conception, for the ear conception, for the nose conception of self. No. So yoga. And yoga then is involving not being in touch with sense objects for the pleasure of the senses. It is the sound of silence. That is yoga. Yoga speech is the sound of silence. What is the sound of silence? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. One time some of my godbrothers went and they had to talk to a yogi who never spoke. He had taken them on a ride. So, to communicate, he would write on a chalkboard. So they went to see him and he said, our guru, he said, better than not talking is to only talk about Krishna. He said this to the yogi. Pretty bold, huh? Pretty stupid too, because the yogi wrote on the chalkboard, is that what you do? Only talk about Krishna. And they knew, no, it's not. They told me the story. I said, well, then you should have said no. But our guru only talks about Krishna, so let us take it again. But they didn't think that fast. So not talking is one thing, but talking about Krishna only. That is more than not talking. It is said that the God is ineffable. Beyond speech, therefore some people take to silence. But the Gaudiya perspective is, God is ineffable. There's not enough that we can say about Him. The examples there are abundant, thousands of heads and mouths, constantly talking about one aspect of one lila of Krishna. You can't finish the discussion. But one quality of Krishna, can't say enough about it and finish. Krishna is so fascinating that he does not know his own limits, the limits of his own yoga maya. That might bring up a question. Does that mean he's not omniscient? He does not know his own limits? No, because he doesn't have limits. See, you're supposed to stop thinking now. Yeah, just chant. His Swarup Shakti has no limits. What is it? How will we manifest his Swarup Shakti, Yoga Maya, always shadowing him to please him? He knows his desire before it manifests, and manifests something in place in constantly newer and newer manifestations of service, and you will be one of them. How will you appear in the spiritual world like a new person when everything there is eternal? Because you will appear as a particular Bhagavat, what's already there. And the nature of that bhava is such that it always presents itself in newer and newer ways for the pleasure of Krishna. And once it does so, then he knows that this is Prabhupada's explanation. As soon as a new thing is planted, then he knows that. As soon as it expands in another way, then he knows that. He knows everything. Something like that. He has no limits. He does not know the limits of the Swarup Shakti because she has no limits. So yoga in Bhakti Yoga, very beautiful, something to talk about. How to use the tongue, how to use the ears, how to use the mind, not for their own purpose, but for the purpose of Bhagavan's, pleasing Bhagavan's senses. Kama means to please one's own senses, and praying means to please the senses of Krishna. So this is a very friendly type of yoga. But, like I said, it's only easy in comparison to other types of yoga. So it's not so easy to only talk about Krishna. Until we get a taste. Until we get a taste. Until the medicine becomes food. So please take your medicine. It will turn into food. Hearing, chanting about Krishna. That's very nice. But Arjuna expresses some concern because Krishna hasn't really fully come out of Bhakti Yoga yet. At the end of the 6th chapter, he emphasizes it again. And then in the 7th chapter, 8th chapter, 9th chapter, 10th chapter, 11th chapter, 12th chapter, the theology of the Gita, it seems like Krishna is just talking about himself. A very self-centered person. I am this, I am that. The first 6 chapters, he only talked about us. That's good. We are amazing, he said. We are extraordinary in every way, very attractive. Now, in the 7th chapter, 8th chapter, 9th, the middle of the Gita, he's talking about himself. But he's really not talking about himself. It's a misunderstanding. What do you mean?
Krishna, everything comes from me.
How is he not talking about himself? He's not. It's a misunderstanding. Krishna is talking about bhakti. And if he talks about bhakti, he has to talk about himself because he's the object of bhakti. So he cannot talk about bhakti without talking about himself. So what he's talking about is bhakti. Yes. Only in the Krishna's preoccupied with. He's only controlled and locked up by bhakti. What kind of yoga is that? The Bhagavan himself is completely controlled by that yoga. What is the power? But at the end of the 6th chapter, Krishna has not come out with this fully. What is bhakti? So he's talked about yoga. And he's told Arjuna, forgo the dharma. Forget about that. Dharmashram. Forget about that. It's misery from beginning to end. Yeah, I can go to heaven just to fall down again. Waste of time. If you do it perfectly, you can go to heaven and you'll disappear and then come down. Even good intentions bring suffering, and this will work. So, don't think in terms of bodies, you are not hungry. But think about stop thinking, do yoga. But yoga is difficult. Stopping from thinking is difficult. Krishna says, yes, it's a little difficult, that's true. But with practice, it's possible. But Arjuna then poses the question, the end of the 6th chapter, says, well, what if I'm not successful in yoga? I've given up the Dharma, so now the Yamadutas are already coming after me. The long hand of Yama, of the law, is going to come to apprehend me. I have not done my duty. But you say it's okay, I'll do yoga instead. But what if I'm not successful in yoga? Then what? And what does Krishna say? He's obviously talking about bhakti yoga. In full sense of the term, when he says, you can never be successful in yoga. To emphasize the point, he says, look, if you do the Dharma perfectly, you can go to heaven. But if you do the yoga imperfectly, you can go to heaven. So don't worry about it, he said. If you imperfectly do this yoga, you go to heaven. And you go there with a different reason in mind, with a different samskara. And you can stay there long enough in heaven, then my leela will come on earth, and then you come from there and participate in my leela. That's possible. Some of Krishna's friends, when he appears, they come from heaven. They are also sovereign seekers. It's mentioned that they don't know son of the first time. Or they come from earth as sovereign seekers and make the leela. And he says, and if your practice has gone on for a long time and you're close to being successful, then you won't go to heaven. But then you'll be born in the Vaikuntha. Where? How? Oh, I mean, he says, you'll be born in a family of devotees who are real devotees, transcendentalists. And you'll take up yoga, this bhakti, you'll get it. From the very beginning of your life. And there the prophet says, and that's what happened to me. So the same prophet described himself as a sovereign citizen in several places in the text, in his books. This is one of the places. And I was fortunate to take birth in a family of transcendentalists. And he said, like my Guru Maharaj was also. And this is one place. Another place he describes himself in this way. So I was making a point in this conversation that I was inviting him to, and he asked a comment from the Prabhupada has described himself as a sovereign citizen. There was some resistance to that idea as if it was a it was a bad thing. No, we must be religious about it. So I explained that the Prabhupada himself has said one thing. And he's also said another thing. He said he's a sadhu so he described himself out in that way. And he's also said that there's no difference between siddhas. Siddha means siddha. So he's weighed in definitively on the subject. Still there was resistance, and I said, the reason there is resistance is because we don't understand what is an intercid. You think that an intercid is somehow better than a sovereign citizen. So what is your understanding of what is an intercid? What type of intercid? Do you know there are different types? So I have an online explaining all these things and so forth. There are parshas, there are arunas. These are different types of leaders. They are anadi siddha samskara. Anadi siddha samskara. Unlike us, who get bhakti samskaras through sadhu sangha, and thus impressions on our chitta that determine our bhava, our rasa, in due course. Nityasiddhas have what is called anadisiddha samskara, a beginningless, perfect tendency for serving Krishna. And through them, and through there, which comes to us through the Guru Parampara, these kinds of samskaras come on us, they're new. They are beginning. for us. They have no end. So anyway, I was explaining there are different types of emphases. And furthermore, the fact of the matter is that there is, for all intents and purposes, no hierarchy in the spiritual world. And this is a statement of Swami Tripurari in a book that it seems to be speaking about a hierarchy in the spiritual world. You know, Vaidhi, he's taking us to different levels and so forth and so on. And he makes a very strong statement. This is only, you have to read carefully to find it, this is only the creation. It's not the experience of Vaikuntha that one devotee is higher than another. The experience of Vaikuntha is, I am perfect. In my love for Krishna, in Dasya Bhakti, in Sakya Bhakti, in Madhurya Bhakti, is perfect. And if I have any interest in any other rasa, which happens, it plays itself out in such a way that it enhances my own rasa and takes it to new heights. So this idea that my guru must be an indecisive or otherwise there's a problem, it's not very well thought out. It's unbecoming. It's actually in the name of glorification. It's kind of an over-glorification that is outside of the Siddhanta or Tattva. But this is something that would not be offered to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So God would say, we don't want to love him. Remember I was saying how the world of rasa and feeling is grounded in some wisdom. We call it Siddhanta. And there are different siddhantas, as I say, for different lineages and different bhavas, different experiences in transcendence. And Rupa Goswami has just given a basic kind of outline map. There are many possibilities. But if you want to talk about the bhava, please give us all the siddhanta. In a sense, it can be supported by the sacred text and so forth. So, Prahlad is described repeatedly as a sadhana siddha. Sanatana calls him, describes him as a sadhana siddha. In Bhagavatam, he's described as such. Again and again and again. His deity is Krishna. Again and again, the seventh canto of Bhagavatam, this is pointed out. He was worshipping Krishna, and it was Krishna who appeared as Nishuna, the chakra of Krishna. It is said, maybe in Bhagavatam or Tathagata Goswami, to meet the needs of the Sharanagata. His surrendered soul, Gopurde, Rakshikshat, Vishvashu, only Krishna will protect us. We should think like this. That's how Prahlad thought and imagined. He had to appear in a particular form, given the particular circumstances, and the blessing of Brahma was given to Rani Kasipu, you know, the story. So, Rupa Goswami, Jiva Goswami is described as Raga Bhakta. In Bhagavatam, he said that his attraction to Krishna was like an astrological pull on someone, that just automatically takes them in that direction from his very childhood. So he describes him as a Raga Bhakta. One segue, he's a devotee of Krishna. Krishna is also manifestation in Vaikuntha, that would be Vaidhi Bhakti, Krishna Dwaraka, Vaidhi Bhakti, Krishna Mathura also, you can serve him Vaidhi Bhakti there, or you're going to serve there in this Vaidhi Bhakti and Raga Bhakti. So when I began, I was thinking about Prahlad, of course, he's not in Raja, but wait a minute. For that matter, he's a sadhana siddha. So when we see Prahlad, we're only seeing sadhana deva. What is the siddha deva? Do you understand? His practitioner's body, he got the, it's perfect. He got the darshan and mishnade. And what kind of bhava does mishnade get? Well, according to give, according to bhakti vinod, in Navadvi, he gives Radha bhakti for Radha and Krishna. So, Prahlad is the dearest person. Jiva Goswami has described and has Raga Bhakti. I wanted to say that the spectrum of Raga Bhakti extends beyond the brush to include obviously people like Prahlad. I suppose, as we're talking about it, it could be thought of a little differently as well. Nonetheless, there is Vaidhi Bhakti for Krishna, there is Raga Bhakti for Krishna. Ambarish is a Vaidhi Bhakti. Nara Vaidhi Bhakti of Krishna. And there's mixture. So what is the mixture? That is a question. So this subject is covered in Raghavar Chandrika of Vishnu Chakritaka. And he says, for example, if you want to pursue Madhurasa because you've been influenced by the Alvars, for example. Some of the Alvars, the founders of the Sri Sampradaya, from their poetry, from their bhava, the great Amuja came to articulate their bhava, to take their bhava and explain in terms of math, the math of their bhava, the tattva. This is like in music, there's math behind music. There's math behind art. We don't see it, we just see the art. We just hear the music and we feel the bhava. But there's actually math underlying that. So to really be in the bhava of an artist, you have to know the math. You have to see the notes. When you make a sound, there's a geometric shape which corresponds with it. It's the math. You understand? So math means Vedanta. And bhakti means vibhava. There's a Vedanta, there's a Siddhanta, there's Tattva. These mean the same thing. That underlies vibhava. You have to be acquainted with that. What is the point? The taste of bhava. So, in Raghavarma Chandrika, he says that these queens of Dwarka, they have mixed bhakti, mixed Raja and Vaishnava. If you want Madhurasa, like the Alvars, you can find in their prayers the sentiments of Rukmini in Sri Sampradaya. Some of them. And Ramanuja is taking these kind of prayers, poems of the Alvars, and turning and giving the math. It's called Vishishta Dvaita. Vishishta Dvaita Tattva. What an accomplishment. How much you understood the power to do that? To give us a Siddhanta supported by the scriptures, corresponding with that bhava. So, Chakravarti Thakur says that if you want the Raga Bhakti of Vrindavan that Rupa Goswami is talking about, then you are sentiment for Rock that comes through Sadhusanga. You all want to go to Vrindavan, right? Want to go to Vrindavan? Worship Krishna in Vrindavan, or do you want to go to Vaikuntha? Okay, just got that. So we are all Raga bhaktis. Good. Just beginning a little bit, Raga bhakti, through Sadhusanga. Without even thinking about it, you see, we have samskara through Sadhusanga. With that Prabhupada, for example, and his father, for this thing. We have this kind of samskara. So, Vishnu Chakravarti says, if you want this kind of bhakti, then it should be supported with Vaidhi bhakti of hearing, chanting, remembering, and all the angas of Vaidhi bhakti, except for a few. One of the angas of Vaidhi bhakti is worshiping the queens of Dwarka, Rupa Goswami Swami lists it. And Vishwanath Chakravarti says, don't do that one. Because then you become a queen in Dwarka, and you will have mixed Prag and Vaidhi bhakti. That's an example. A mixture of Raga and Vaidhi bhakti. So it's not in our interest to become a queen of Dwarka. That you want that, you can go to the Sri Sampradaya. And we know that because of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He made that information available. So this is my long and roundabout answer to the question. Yes, Marge.
Oh, I was just going to say something. We're amazed.
Yes.
As you mentioned, Balaram and Angamantar,
so
say more about the connection.
Well, I say that Anandamajari is only the consort of Balaram. He does have some goals, that's true. But in his own personal Shakti manifestation, he's also worshipping Krishna, as he himself is. And the gopis that he marries in Braj, he marries after returning to Vrindavan on the order of Nanda Maharaj. And when he plays with the gopis along with Krishna in the, what is that being called? With Sankachuda, the holy lila, holy, you know, holy. The description of Balaram with gopis in Vrindavan, in the Bhagavatam, is before he goes to Mathura and Dwarka, is restricted to the holy festival. Holy festival, we call it Festival of Colors. Now it's a very popular thing. People get together and squirt colors on one another and so forth. But this holy in Vrindavan, celebrated by Krishna and Balaram and gopis, includes gopas. If you study the Bhagavatam in the commentaries, you see when Krishna performed holy with the gopikas, Balaram was there and other gopas were there. This is not like Rasa Lila. Understand? This is not like Krishna's Rasa Lila. Balaram not quite like that. He likes Krishna's Rasa Lila for Krishna. When he returned from Dwarka and he spoke to Krishna's gopis, what happened? He so much represented Krishna that he turned black. There's a famous Taoji deity in Vrindavan, black. He represented Balaram in this room. So representing Krishna. In other words, he doesn't see Radha's gopi, Radha and gopis as Krishna for himself. He has no interest in that. This is Guru. He has no interest in the disciples for his or her own sake and pleasure, only representing Krishna. Whatever you give, we give it to Krishna. If it can't stop short, it must be given to Krishna. Then he prays, and money is better for Krishna. And infection. Then, like that person, we come. That's very tricky. But Balaram has his own gopis. But these gopis, he married in Gopal Chandra's Mishra. After coming back to Vrindavan on a mission to represent Krishna, to tell the gopis, he's coming, don't worry. And then Nandamara said, you know, there's some other gopis here, and